Next Round with the Pacific Research Institute. I'm your host, Rowena Ichon. Tim and I are PRI's Senior Director of Communications, and I chatted with Dr. Mark Skousen, one of the most prominent libertarians in the country and founder of FreedomFest, the largest gathering of libertarians in the world. Dr. Skousen also teaches economics at Chapman University. In this podcast, we chat a little bit about everything: the economic impact of the coronavirus, the financial markets, politics, California, and his thoughts on teaching economics to a new generation. Thanks for joining us. Welcome to PRI's Next Round, Dr. Skousen.
Well, glad to be with you.
So let's start off and chat about the health of the economy first, which has been at risk lately because of the outbreak of the coronavirus. Do you think that the coronavirus may take the country into a long recession, or do you see a bounce back once the virus is under control?
Well, we're facing both, definitely. We're looking for a severe recession right now because of the draconian methods that have been used to shut down the economy. I think this was a very bad move, and it's indicative of an overweening government that is just way too powerful and has too much power. They can do all these things with emergency powers and executive authority, and it just takes some time to get back on our feet. So we're Americans. I think we can respond to this, but we're definitely not doing as well as how they've done in South Korea, in Singapore, Hong Kong. The Asian countries that have faced this pandemic have done a much better job of containing it without destroying their business. So they'll go through a minor recession, but we're going through a severe recession with heavy unemployment and loss of jobs, loss of businesses that may never come back. I think we just overreacted to this coronavirus attack. I mean, I went back historically and looked at the past. We've never done this. This is unprecedented to stop all businesses or the majority of businesses. Now, we probably did this time because more people can now work at home online, but it's still a tremendous cost to our economy, to jobs, and it's really political. It's threatened Trump and the Republicans' chance of re-election, in my opinion.
Along with destroying the economy, it's destroying many people's 401ks. I have refrained from looking at my 401k during this period, but I know that you are known as an excellent stock picker. So for our listeners at home, what would be your strategy now, given all the market gyrations we're seeing, up, down 1,000 one day, up 2,000 the next?
Yeah, Tim, that's a good... That's good. And I think we might have to say excellent stock picker in the past, use the past tense. My stocks, like almost everybody's, have been clobbered. We have imposed some stop orders 20% below our stop prices. So we were stopped out at quite a few of our positions. And there's an old saying, you know, I've collected all these sayings on Wall Street in a little book called The Maxims of Wall Street. And it's very comforting to read these quotes. And one of them is from the late Dick Russell of the Dow Theory Letters. He said, in a bear market, the winner is he who loses the least. You know, everybody is hurt one way or another. Even people who have shorted the market and walk away saying they made money, well, they probably lost in other assets. Their real estate has gone down or what have you. I mean, it takes a toll on everybody. And you want to minimize your risks as much as possible. We're down, but not as much as the market, because we took a gold position. We've shorted the market from time to time. And there's been a liquidity crunch, if you will, for international, for foreigners and so forth to buy the dollar, even though our economy is weak right now. It was strong, it was weak, but the dollar remains pretty strong. So there's a couple of things that we have done to minimize our losses. We're not profiting tremendously, believe me, from this. And, you know, I think it will make a comeback. I mean, you have Federal Reserve engaging in extraordinary easy money policies, quantitative easing, even buying corporate bonds this time and not just treasury bills, and lowering interest rates to zero. The money supply is growing very fast. But just like 2008, it takes months before all of this really kicks in. And then on top of it, you have a very aggressive action to bail out the economy to the tune of $2 trillion, which is going to add dramatically to our deficit problem, our national debt problem down the road. But it's a short-term strategy to get the economy going. But frankly, no bailout is big enough to make up for the loss of businesses that is going on right now with the lockdown.
I just want to follow up on that, Dr. Skousen. Why do you think gold hasn't shot up?
Actually, gold has gone up quite a bit this year. It's up over 30%. But if you're talking about just the last few months, there's another saying on Wall Street that when the paddy wagon rolls up, they take the good girls with the bad. And what we mean by that is that so many institutions and so many hedge funds and private equity were so leveraged with these low interest rates that were prevalent and still are there that the unwinding required these institutions to sell everything. So the good stocks, the gold, even including gold, has really taken a hit in gold stocks as well, but not as much. Notice that gold itself has dropped a little bit, but it hasn't dropped 40%, 50% like some of these individual stocks. So I actually think once this crisis subsides a bit, then we're going to face seeing huge inflationary pressures because of the increases in money, in the printing of money and the quantitative easing. And with the low interest rates, that's very favorable toward gold stocks. So I expect to see a big rally in our gold stocks, and we're actually taking a position in a number of the top mining companies around the world right now.
Oh, that's great news, because I've got a gold portfolio and I was wondering, should I buy a little more? Maybe this is a good time to do it.
Buy on the dips, they say.
So I wanted to follow up on something you said a little earlier about, you know, now we're figuring out that we can actually work from home on these shelter-in-place orders, and like me, going a little stir-crazy staring at the four walls of my house. I'm interested in your thoughts on, after we get through this crisis, what might the economy look like as far as the future of work? You know, we've had a lot of discussion about the future of work, California being the epicenter of it with automation and robotics, and certainly the heavy debate that we've had in recent months about who is an independent contractor and who is an employee. How do you think that the coronavirus might actually accelerate this trend, I think inevitable trend toward, some are comparing it to, you know, it's our next of many economic revolutions in the United States, this move toward, you know, a fully automated work world?
Yeah, I don't see it as fully automated. Certainly, the robots which are making automobiles right now, if people aren't driving, and certainly the demand for gasoline and oil products has dropped precipitously, as indicated by the drop in the oil prices. I do think that you have to make a distinction between automation and robotics and the online revolution where people are working at home. I mean, they closed Chapman University, where I teach, and both my wife and I, we have to do everything online now, and we're all getting up to speed on how to do that effectively. I struggle with it, but we will develop a way to teach that way so that we have this quick alternative when this happens and happens again. And we will adjust, because we are problem solvers, and I think that that will be beneficial. I see kind of a stagnating economy, really, at this point. If we live in constant fear that business is going to have to lay off millions of workers. It's not like everybody went home and served restaurant food at home. You can only do so much in terms of takeout and that sort of thing. So there's a lot of adjustment that's being taken place here. And frankly, we need to get back to work. My best comparison is, I think we're using a sledgehammer to crack a nut. And I'm really worried about the impact on that. So while we will make some adjustments on online learning, and I mean, my newsletter, my financial publications, everybody's working from home, and we are still working. We're still producing products. So it's not like it's destroying all of the economy. I mean, look at Amazon. Amazon, they're hiring. Walmart is hiring. Costco, you know, there's a lot of companies that seem to be benefiting, that are still open, but on a net balance, this is pretty devastating to the economy.
What about business travelers like ourselves? It's hard to think that people will still get on a plane if, for example, even right now, Tim is in Sacramento, you're in Orange County, I'm in Pasadena. 5 years ago, we would have all tried to get together to do this interview, but now we can arrange it instantly. Do you think people, given that they can do Zoom and all of these fantastic online conference services, that people will continue to fly as much as they have on business?
Well, yeah, I think that is another factor that we're going to see some significant changes, because really the airline profits have been directly linked to business travel, and it's been that for a long period of time. But now that may shift again, and we switched to Zoom. We're using Panopo in Blackboard at our university. You can see the students and get their reaction. You can see the business partners across the table. That's really helpful, no question about that. And so that's going to become more and more viable as time goes along. So the airlines are really struggling, and this is a major bailout that they're engaging in. The cruise ships, of course, is not normally a business type of thing. They're hurting, but we already heard about them planning. I just heard from Royal Caribbean that they're planning to start cruising again in mid-May. So at least that's what their schedule is. So that's positive news for that. The whole area of entertainment is really a major factor. The vacations and that sort of thing. That's a huge industry worldwide, and that's really been devastated now. We need to get back to work on this. And so I was really hopeful that we got that message to President Trump, and he is responding favorably to that, but he's held hostage right now to the healthcare experts.
Obviously, things have shifted a bit in the last month or so, but looking at President Trump and his economic record, how do you rate him? What grade would you give him? On one hand, we see unemployment, up to now has been very good. Obviously, that's going to change a lot when the next reports come out. He's certainly been committed to deregulation, and he's been pushing corporate tax cuts. But, on the other hand, we've had all the trade war issues, and the debt and deficit have not been a problem, and certainly are going to grow a lot, a lot bigger after this congressional coronavirus bill goes through. So taking all that into account, what do you think of President Trump's overall economic performance?
Well, as a professor, I kind of like to think you asked him what grade I would give, and he's the kind of the student who initially, I'm very hopeful. I'm looking through the midterm exams, and I'm noticing he's doing really well. He's answering all the questions. He's making the right choices. And then suddenly it all kind of falls apart at the last part of the test. I've actually had several students like that. So, I give Trump very high marks for cutting corporate taxes. That was really beneficial, reducing onerous regulations on business. I think those are the factors that have resulted in record high stock prices and low unemployment for everyone, including minorities. So I was really pleased overall with that. But he starts to go off the tracks here with his protectionist statements, stuff like every Apple iPhone should be manufactured in America. Consumers to pay $3,000 for an iPhone. So, and maybe he didn't mean it. Maybe that's one of his methods of art of the deal sort of thing. And I certainly agree with him in going after the Chinese for their violation of intellectual property rights. That was really important. But no, as far as draining the swamp, no, there hasn't really been any reduction in the size of government. The EPA is still there. The Department of Education is still there. And the bureaucrats are there long after a Republican who wants to make change has left office. And now we're facing a major crisis. I don't know why Republicans in particular seem to end their presidential cycle with a crisis. We had that problem with President Bush, and that's why President Obama was elected. Now we're facing a major crisis. Let's see how he's handling it. But when he signed an executive order against hoarding and price gouging, thing. You can tell he was sleeping during his econ classes. So I just think that he's a little bit weak right now. And I'm hopeful because I have good relations with Larry Kudlow, his chief economic advisor, and Steve Moore and Steve Forbes and Art Laffer and people, the supply siders who are giving him advice. If we can turn this thing around quickly, then he has a chance for re-election. But if it drags on into the election, I see the Democrats really winning big in November.
Well, that's a good segue to the presidential campaign. So it looks to be a two-man race now on the Democratic side, with Vice President Biden representing the so-called moderates, I guess is what we're calling them now, moderates of the party, and Senator Sanders from the far left. What do you think are the forces that have taken place over the last several years in the U.S. that's given rise to such a socialist-leaning candidate like Sanders?
Well, first of all, I'm glad that the Democrats have chosen a more moderate candidate over a self-proclaimed socialist, although the vote was close for a while. Biden represents more big government, and in a crisis, the Democrats will favor a bigger, more intrusive state, socialized medicine, higher progressive taxation, more taxes on business and investment. I see a stagnating economy coming out of that. And I do think the attraction of Bernie Sanders is a bit of a surprise, but it does come out of the after effects of the financial crisis of 2008. And the inflationary policies of the Fed did benefit the rich more than the middle class and the poor. So you had this inequality issue that kept festering and becoming more and more of a problem. I've been giving talks all around the country on what's better than democratic socialism. So I appeal to all these young people, the millennials who are attracted to that. And my answer is democratic capitalism. That is, when you share the wealth of the capitalist model, and we do this with stock options and profit sharing and, the corporate tax cut, we saw a lot of people getting pay raises and bonuses and that sort of thing. That's really important. It's vital that we adopt a democratic capitalist model where everybody is benefiting and not just the few. So I do think that this has created a watershed issue that we must address rather than simply dismissing it. But I am glad to see that Biden is chosen because he is a little bit more moderate than Senator Sanders, that's for sure. And according to John Stossel's election betting odds, it's really neck and neck right now. One of our speakers at our FreedomFest conference this year is a new speaker named Professor Alan Lichtman. I don't know if you know him or not, but he's at American University. He's written a book called The Keys to the White House. And he has the distinction of having correctly predicted every presidential election from Reagan to Trump. And even he says right now it's too close to call. So he's planning to give us his surprise prediction at our Freedom Fest conference this July.
So do you think that U.S. politics will continue to be as polarized as we've seen it for the foreseeable future? Is there a way to mend fences and bring civility back into politics? You know, one would hope coronavirus would be that kind of natural rallying time. And I think we're kind of seeing it in our communities, but not really on the political scene.
Yeah, and I do blame the media a lot and cable TV on that, and I in a sense I blame ourselves because we've all fallen into this. Rowena, you even used the term far left. You know, I think that these kind of terms are divisive, and sometimes they're even demonizing. There's a lot of bad blood that has developed. I mean, when you have AOC and Elizabeth Warren and Sanders and so on refusing to appear on Fox News and vice versa. You know, Steve Moore was on CNN for a while, but then he was dropped. So there is a real polarizing effort that's going on here, and I think it's really unfortunate. And what I'd like to see is for us to focus on best solutions more than name calling and labeling. So in my own writings, in my newsletter at Freedom Fest and so on, we completely avoid the left right, you're right, we're you're wrong kind of mentality, and together together, we invite people of free minds, open-mindedness, to come together, and we have lots of debates, and they're civil debates. We had Paul Krugman and Steve Moore on our main stage debate several years ago at Freedom Fest, and it was very civil. There was no catcalling. There was no talking over each other. Everyone got to speak their mind. And so I don't go as far as to call them liberals and progressives. I don't give them that luxury, but I do refer to them as social democrats. I think that's an objective term that you can use. I mean, ultimately, there's two kinds of people politically. I like to divide them into libertarians, where you make your own choice on what you want to do in life. And then there's the authoritarians, who are always telling us what to do. And so today, more and more, everything is either prohibited or mandated. So we're being squeezed from both sides in the freedom movement. So I'd like to see us tone down the rhetoric. And, you know, Ronald Reagan said something way back in 1964 in his famous speech on TV for Goldwater. He said, there's no left or right, there's only up or down. And I think what he meant by that was, let's focus on solutions, not who is right, but what is right. So if we do that, and we do it in a civil manner, and we actually talk to each other, and that's what we do at our Freedom Fest conference, we have more debates than anything else. So we invite people. I mean, like Alan Lichtman, he's a longtime Democrat, and he's one of our keynote speakers at our conference. And I think we need to see more of that, to be honest with you.
Dr. Skousen, so you're one of the few people who actually moved to California and not run away from California. So what's your impression of our state? Do you think there'll ever be a time when we can restore a little more balance to the state's politics? What's it going to take?
Well, both my wife, Joanne, and I were born in California, actually, but we haven't lived here until just this last November. We lived most of our lives on the East Coast and abroad. We lived in the Bahamas and we lived in London. But anyway, since we've moved here, and we bought a beautiful home overlooking Orange County, and we've had a number of events there, and I'm just really impressed with the outdoorsiness, if you will, with the climate and so forth, the beach, the mountains, the outdoor lifestyle, and particularly the friendliness, the Western hospitality of the people at church and in our neighborhood. It's truly remarkable. We had an open house at our house, our new home, just a couple months ago, and lots of people coming, and political differences just didn't matter. It was just the friendliness. So I think people are leaving for other reasons, leaving California. Understand the high cost of housing and the high cost of living. Although I will say, we have homes in Florida and New York and now in California, and real estate taxes here are by far the lowest. By far the lowest. It's half what it is in Florida and New York. Of course, I understand they may be trying to change that, but everything else is high priced, and taxes and regulations and income taxes. And it does seem like the Democrats are doing everything they can to drive people out of the Golden State. And I think it's really unfortunate. And the whole shutdown, I mean, to close beaches and liquor stores and it just seems like everybody just goes overboard here whenever there's and the fiscal sanity is a real question mark, I think.
So you're teaching now at Chapman University. How have you found the overall experience working with all of the young people? I guess it's Gen Z is the name for their generation, not millennials. I've seen a lot of people on Twitter saying don't call them millennials. Is there a dominant political makeup of the students that you work with? And, you know, as a professor, what do you do to try to get them to be open-minded in their thinking?
Well, my wife teaches English lit and poetry, and both of us are really pretty impressed. I mean, the students here are largely from California. They're from all over the world, but there is really quite a nice mix of students at Chapman University. And they seem to be quite open-minded and influenced, as they all are, by the professors. But I think there's a nice balance at Chapman, and I'd like to see more of that. I mean, I've taught at Columbia University. I've taught at Mercy College. I've taught at Rollins College in Florida, all over the place. And we need more diversity. They should have an actual program of diversity. And Chapman does that. And the fact that they have me coming in and teaching free market economics, and they have Vernon Smith, the Nobel Prize winner here, but they also have a number of professors in the other departments who are social Democrats. I wouldn't call them progressives. And so it's nice to see students can get both perspectives there. And, you know, you have Chapman University is unique because we have statues in the campus because the president, Jim Doty, is a former student of Milton Friedman at University of Chicago. And Daniele Struppa, who's the current president from Italy, is a mathematician, but very libertarian and a regular speaker at FreedomFest. We have statues of Milton Friedman, Ronald Reagan, Margaret Thatcher, Ayn Rand. Have you ever heard of a campus with a statue of Ayn Rand? So it's nice to see that kind of diversity. And to be honest with you, these students are really very bright, very determined to succeed in life. It's kind of restoring my faith in America, to be honest with you. I think everyone should who would like to teach, volunteer and teach at local communities and so on and try to make a difference, because if we don't change the young people in life, we're at sea without rudder, and who knows where it would lead. I have one of my most popular textbooks is called The Making of Modern Economics, and it's the book that the new socialists fear the most, because as you know, lots of people have written books, including Senator Rand Paul, attacking capitalism, but those are being read by adults, not students. My textbook, The Making of Modern Economics, has the most devastating chapters on socialism and Keynesianism that really have ever been written. I mean, I've gotten letters from people saying it has changed their lives from being a Marxist to being a free market person, and there are people from all over the world. So if you write a textbook that students are actually using, that has a tremendous, far more impact than just writing to adults. By the way, I should mention that last year I received my favorite professor award from Chapman University. So I have to be really pleased with what's going on campus.
Dr. Skousen, I actually own that book. It's sitting in my bookcase right now. So I have that.
Oh, wow.
I think you autographed it for me.
yes, indeed. It really is. It's the only textbook in economics that has on the story of the great economic thinkers, with chapters on Milton Friedman and the Austrians, Mises and Hayek, as well as devastating chapters on Marx and Keynes, and a whole chapter on Adam Smith. Adam Smith is the heroic figure of the book. So anyway, I'm waxing enthusiastic about my own book, but still it's making a big difference. And it's got lots of pictures and storytelling. It's the kind of thing that students really enjoy.
Yeah, I think it's a classic. So finally, we can't let you go without talking about the greatest gathering of libertarians in the world. That's Freedom Fest. So for our listeners who might not be familiar with it, and perhaps you can give them some background on it and highlight some of your leading speakers this year.
Well, thank you very much. Freedom Fest is close to my heart and something that I decided to do when I was president of the Foundation for Economic Education back in 2001. I said, why don't we have a national convention or even an international convention and bring together all the freedom lovers and think tanks so that we can learn from each other and network and socialize and celebrate liberty? Because I thought, you know, we're all a herd of cats, we're all doing our thing, and are we really making a difference? And I think there is strength in numbers, and my idea is to bring together as many people as possible. We chose Las Vegas as the most libertarian town in the world, and people, and it's relatively cheap compared to other cities, and it's just been a huge success. We have thousands of people who come every year. We have new speakers, and we always have a big keynote speaker. In the past, we've had William Shatner, we've had George Foreman, we had Kevin O'Leary last year, and a couple years ago, we even had Donald J. Trump himself. So, and we have lots of senators, think tanks, freedom organizations. We have an exhibit hall. John Mackey of Whole Foods and Steve Forbes are our co-ambassadors, and they're there the entire time. you get to meet and spend time with with all the speakers, including the big name speakers. This year, we have Dr. Jordan Peterson coming, who, for those who don't know, is the clinical psychologist from Canada, who's written a classic book, 12 Rules for Life, that has sold millions. And he defends free speech and personal responsibility in a world that's gone chaotic, has a huge following among young people. If you go to YouTube and just Google, and I'm sure you guys are familiar with Jordan Peterson, he has millions of views on his various workshops and speeches that he's given. So he's going to be there for all day. Our dates are July 13th through the 16th, and it happens to be at the exact same time as the Democratic National Convention. Now, we're hoping the Democrats are still going to have their convention because of this virus thing. Las Vegas is shut down, and Milwaukee is shut down where the Democratic Convention is, but we're very hopeful that this will be open by July. I certainly hope so, because if the country is still shut down by July, we're in a Great Depression scenario. So I don't think that's going to happen. We already have over 800 people signed up, and none have canceled. So we're just very excited. And we are going to have an emergency meeting at the conference, and we're hoping that Pacific Research and you guys will be there as well, because we're inviting all the think tanks and the freedom organizations and Reason and Cato and Heartland and Heritage and Mises. It's be great. Nobel Prize winning economist Vernon Smith and his wife Candace is coming. Tom Woods for the first time. Matt Ridley from the UK. The Libertarian Party is going to be there. And we also have the Anthem Film Festival, which my wife runs. And it happens to also be the 40th anniversary of my investment newsletter, Forecasts and Strategies. So we have a big investment conference. There's something there for everybody. So if people go to freedomfest.com, they can read all about it. So how's that for a summary?
Thanks very much, Dr. Skousen.
Hey, my pleasure. It's just been wonderful speaking with you guys, and I hope the best for our country. We love our country, and we hate to see it facing this kind of a crisis, and we're going to get over it, but we got to make the right decisions.
Special thanks to Dr. Mark Skousen. If you like this episode, please tell your friends and subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, or TuneIn. And please do us a favor and give us 5 stars. You can also listen to our podcast on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/Pacific Research 1. That's the number 1. Thanks for listening. I'm Marina Ishmael. Hope you'll come back again for next round with PRI.